this look scary? Is it? No, you would touch it, would you? Of course you would. Would you think the same is about hyperbolic geometry? Yeah? No?
Yes.
Why? Oh, that's good, 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 good. Good, so well, why not? Okay, well, here's my story. It's 1977. I'm a senior in University of Latvia, not just across the channel here. Up in those tiny windows, three windows, there was an auditorium. I'm sitting there, senior, having a great dream. So what am I going to do after the graduation? All of us have at that age. Well, but there are a couple classes I need to finish, and one of them is hyperbolic geometry. Well, not my favorite one, but required one. And I have trouble with it. I was a good student, generally, but I had the trouble with that. And, well, what's the case? What happened? Well, at that time, seemed like this hyperbolic geometry asked for me too much imagination. The instructor drew these two pictures on a chalkboard, and said, well, so this on the left side, that one is in Euclidean geometry, the right one is in Lobachevskian geometry, all of them are correct. I had the question, why? Well, the answer was, well, you have to make an assumption, or you have to imagine that. How can I imagine something, which I don't know what to imagine? That was pre-Google era. And, well, and then my previous experience tell me, so that I can't make assumption, because my previous experience is only one of them can be correct. Anyway, I had this puzzling question, but I finished the class and disliked it. It was pass-fail, so I passed, otherwise I wouldn't be here. Well, but I truly believed, well, that's it. I will never have to think about hyperbolic geometry again. It wasn't in my dreams that 20 years later, I am on the other side of the world, at Cornell University, and facing the fact, fall semester, I have to teach hyperbolic geometry. Well, so I couldn't use my previous experience. I didn't want my students to think about that course like I was thinking about it. So I had to do something. I attended a workshop, and that's where I first saw this model of hyperbolic plane. My fingers itched to touch it. I wasn't allowed, because that thing would fall apart. I tried to make something, a replication, well, something like this. So I had to do something. I had to make something tactile model. What I faced is that I faced the problem that I had to visualize and make in a tactile way exponential growth. So I remembered how as a child I was taught about powers of two and how the exponential growth comes through rumors. You know, I have something, I tell, you know, like I tell bubbles and just don't tell anybody else, but next day all of us, just one more person. So, well, and so on, so it goes. Well, nowadays, you mention Ponzi scheme, and that's it, everybody gets point. It's easier. At the same workshop, I just drew this pattern, and then I thought, okay, oh, and then my aha moment happened. This looks like a crochet pattern. The same night I started to crochet. So the stitches grow exponentially. Instead of crocheting flat, I started to add stitches to increase number of the stitches. They grow exponentially, so I had to slow it down. And first model came too crunchy. I couldn't do anything. So I tried, okay, I need to slow down this exponential growth and make this ratio closer to one. So I tried the next one, which is closer to the one, and now I could do some things that I can show. So how can I get a straight line on a hyperbolic plane? Well, if I have a plain sheet of paper, then I can get a perfect straight line just by folding it. Here we go. Okay, so I can do the same thing if I have a hyperbolic plane. Now I can use this, and now you will see that this is it. Okay, well, yeah, so I can fold it the same way, but doesn't look nice. That's how it goes. Well, but if I have a crocheted one, I can fold it nicely, and here I have a straight line. So I kept folding, and voila, here was a picture which I had so much trouble to imagining as a student. So that here is a, thank you. So here's another version. That was the original one. So here it is. Here is a straight line, and here are the lines which are intersecting, but all of these three lines here, but that means if threes are can be infinitely many, wouldn't cross the third one. And from what it comes? It comes just, my understanding came, and so do my students, luckily, came from the simple fact, if I fold it, then in a tactile way, through my fingers, I can really experience. Yeah, so that these two lines come closer only at one point, and then they diverge away on both sides. And that is that phenomena on this hyperbolic plane, which is actually hard to imagine if you are not having, like this experience. Well, now you have a question. Why do we care about hyperbolic plane, don't you? Well, I can tell you, it's actually very rich and beautiful. You won't believe it, but that's true. And also, this is it gives us the way to think about the shapes in nature. I'll show you some examples a little later. It also makes us think about the shape of our universe, which is a puzzling question for thousands of years. And actually, it's still an open question, what is the real shape of our universe? Well, I'm not going that far, but I can show you some interesting properties from the hyperbolic plane. First, to understand that, we have to understand how we are characterizing hyperbolic plane. So, well, what's happening is, if we are having a surface which has constant curvature, then we can define a geometry on it. And if we can define a geometry on it, then we can describe it. Well, what is a curvature? We all know this, there are positive numbers, negative numbers, and zero in between. We can do the same. We can do the same analogy with surfaces, and that was suggested by Carl Friedrich Gauss early 19th century. So he said, why don't we characterize the surfaces also with a curvature? And that can also, in a two dimensions, it can also be flat. This is more or less the floor I'm standing on. It's flat. And so, well, therefore, curvature is zero. Or we can have a constant positive, constant negative. How to get it? Let's use some tilings. If we are having irregular hexagons, we can nicely tile the flat plane. Now, if from these, at each vertex, three hexagons come together, and that gives us perfect 360-degree angle, and it becomes flat. It's no more in fashion, but it will come back. Well, if I remove, at each vertex, I remove one of these hexagons, so then I'm having a pentagon. And eventually, this surface will close. So that is an example of constant positive curvature, or this is a way how to make soccer balls. Nowadays, they change this design, but that's deliberately done to destroy my talk. If I remove a hexagon and instead use heptagon or seven-sided polygon, then you can see that this plane starts to, the surface starts to bend away, it bends again, but now it's infinite. So this is an example of constant negative curvature. And we can explore these things, and we can explore the properties of hyperbolic plane in a way that using these paper models, but of course I have crocheted ones. Well, one of the things we can explore is that what are the sum of the interior angles of a triangle? If we have we all learned in school, in Euclidean plane, it's 180 degrees and it's constant. If we have a sphere, so it's more than 180 degrees. Actually, you can cut an apple or something and just a check, and that really works like that. If we are on a hyperbolic plane, we can have a triangle where interior angles, some of the interior angles are going to zero. It's getting very small, or it can be almost zero, like in this case. Now, so let's go to this model, and if I can demonstrate what happens with this, because as soon as I learn how to crochet a hyperbolic plane, my husband, who is a topologist, he said, you have to make this model. He knows it from the theory, but he never held it in his hands. Well, in hyperbolic plane, I can make a regular octagon with 45-degree angles. That would be, in Euclidean plane, equivalent of a stop sign. And now what I can do is that I can identify or glue these sides. And this way, from this hyperbolic stop sign, I can get something which has a very fancy name in topology, absolutely official. And you can easily guess of it, what it is. So this is hyperbolic pair of bands. Well, so if I continue, so there are two more points which I can identify like this. So you can better see in this blue one on a screen. Identify like this. And then something I forgot to order from organizer. Sorry, I need at this point I need fourth dimension. Can you provide it? Sorry. You have to imagine. Now you have to turn to your imagination. So we can have this hole glue here, and these holes glued together, or this hole here, this one here, and we are getting two-hole torus. That's a proof that two-hole torus has hyperbolic geometry on it. Here we go. Okay, so let's, there is something else we can do. When I was in school, I was taught to write the numbers on a nice, neat square papers, and you had to do very purpley. If I would be in a hyperbolic plane, I wouldn't be able to do it, because if I tried to fold and get right angle things on this hyperbolic plane, so whenever I try, and you are welcome to try that afterwards, I can fold it and get a right angle, but I end up with regular pentagons. There are no right angle squares on hyperbolic plane. So let's go back there. So here is my trials. And this is a close-up of these right angle pentagons on a hyperbolic plane. Well, here are some, these are the things in nature. And now next time you see the nature, you will recognize where the negative curvature is. So this is what we are seeing. Well, of course, there are some stereotypes about mathematics, because when I started to do these presentations 15 years ago, actually started to use these planes, then there were people who said, oh yeah, no, that's great, students liked it, college professors adapted that. But then there were people who said, what are you doing? Mathematicians do not crochet, they do mathematics. There is still the stereotypes that mathematics is something austere and just with some confusing rules and accessible only to some very chosen people. I'm not the one. Well, there is the same thing, by the way, is about the crochet too. So that crochet is something which women do when they have nothing else to do. So when we tried to get to publish an article about crocheting hyperbolic planes in a magazine, though the editor first, his reaction was, what? Crochet instructions in the math journal? So he really didn't believe that that will be something useful. But I convinced him. Well, he published eventually. But I was very happy 3 years later to see another crochet model on the cover of the same magazine. So Hinke Singer and Ben Krauskopf, they made crocheted Lorentz manifold, which they crocheted using a computer-generated pattern, and to show the model of chaos. Well, this is very important. This is, I always use my audience, I always warn it, that for God's sake, please give it up before you start it. Fear it no less than the sensual passion, because it too may take up all your time, deprive you of your health, peace of mind, and happiness in life. That was a warning the father, Wolfgang Bauer, said to his son, Janusz Bauer, one of the discoverers of non-Euclidean geometry, when he said that he wants to do it. Well, it has become viral. So this crocheting hyperbolic planes, it was this idea to explain hyperbolic geometry through them, was adopted by Margaret Wertheim, and she has done it now worldwide, popularizing the project about hyperbolic crochet coral reef. And so this is Latvian reef. It was in 2009, curated by Tia Wieksne. And and even it's, this has made to TED Talk in 2009. So, well, when I was a child, when somebody hears that I'm a mathematician, that nobody, always I hear, oh, I was so bad at math. When I was in school, like this, and this is goes when Andres said about these negative remarks, I was said by art teacher, you might be the best in math, but you are horrible in arts. So therefore, it was like a lightning. When I got an invitation to participate in art shows, and it's my first art show was in 1111 Pennsylvania Avenue, the same one which connects White House with the Capitol in Washington, D.C. So, and I said, yes, you can have my works. But then I thought, well, what on earth am I going to do? Because I'm the mathematician, so I had to learn how to be an artist. The mathematics is not scary when you can touch it. Editor of my book, and it's the best if you can make it yourself. Editor of my book, Charlotte Henderson, after editing my book, she decided to crochet, learn to crochet and crochet one for herself. And then she said, once I did it, so then the properties of hyperbolic geometry, which previously I accepted by my head, now I can accept by my heart. So she even wrote a poem using the crocheting. And crocheting is used, this simple method is connecting people, and it's like really giving inspirations in music and poetry, psychotherapies and biology and physics, and just a lot of friends like that. The great mathematician Bill Thurston, he wrote in the foreword of my book, he wrote that mathematics is an art of human understanding. Mathematics sings if you can feel it with whole your brain. People like music, but they are afraid to sing. You can learn to sing only by singing. So do dare to do unexpected connections, be ready for tears and joy, for praise and rejection. And so, well, now, would you touch it? Could we have some adventures with hyperbolic planes? Thank you.